All right, welcome back to Eye on Sports. Now, the evolution of technology has given additional dimensions for athletes, sporting associations, and other key stakeholders. Recently, accounting firm KPMG published statistical information on social media, on football globally. But are Jamaican athletes and associations lagging behind with the current technological climate? Well, we're going to find out that and more. We've invited marketing and PR specialist Carole Beckford to tell us a little bit more about that. Carole, thank you very much for joining us.
Always my pleasure.
All right, so you've heard the topic, and it's one you're versed in, and you've watched the landscape transform in recent years. I know social media is really a big thing, to put it very simply in layman's terms. Is or are the associations locally, or are the athletes locally, the stars, are they lagging behind where this is concerned, in your estimation?
Well, the athletes are doing better than the organizations. And some of our most outstanding athletes, for example, Chris Gayle, Usain Bolt, Shelly-Ann Fraser-Pryce, Asafa, Julian Fort, who does pretty well with that. Warren Weir has done considerably well. And there are different spots of people. However, associations haven't quite caught up with it. And I think that it's with, for example, TV advertising globally dropping 4% and more people going towards social media. Right. It is a fantastic opportunity to expose your brand to social media platforms. Mm-hmm. Now, there are ways and means to do this. And obviously, because you're already a brand in the context of you running, jumping, hopping, skipping, doing your sport, there are ways and means which you can do it. Mm-hmm. First of all, employ somebody who knows how to do that, how to manage. That's the first thing. And then create a strategy. So you have performances, you have competitions, you have your foundation, you have your community. There's so many elements to the actual athlete that you can expose. And there are different platforms online. There's, for example, Hootsuite, which can manage across all your platforms. And it previews it in such a way that if you have one as your default, it previews it for the other. So Facebook has now become a long-form form of entertainment, I mean, of in terms of content. So it previews it, it gives you a longer preview. Twitter, on the other hand, that has 280 characters, although expanding, is more of a short form. It's quicker, and it has access for a one-minute video. Mm-hmm. Then there's Instagram, which you can post on the regular feed page for, like, a minute. But there's no IGTV that you can... And then there's YouTube. So there are so many different things. But part of it is that you have to consolidate what is determined as your content. So if you're a track and field athlete, you start training from November through to April with basic competitions. All of those things are regarded as a point of content for which you can do exposure. Mm-hmm. In between that, so your training sessions, whether it's your ice baths, your swimming, all of that becomes points of contact for your fans because people want to see. And what social media has done overall is kind of brought it closer to home. So people want to see what you eat, how you sleep, what you wear, all that kind of a thing. So there are so many different elements to that. And I don't think our athletes are exposing themselves without compromising their privacy.
Let me zone in on the associations for a quick minute. The KPMG study, the football benchmark, it obviously, based on the name, focuses on football. Mm-hmm. But if we look at maybe our two most successful sporting associations or the two biggest sports here locally, you'd probably say track and field and football. Mm-hmm. I, for one, haven't really seen this great presence social media-wise from, for example, J3As, which is a governing body for athletics, or the JFF, which I actually think is improving because I've seen a lot more content now on YouTube and so on. Mm-hmm. I've seen, for example, where Cricket West Indies has certainly made it a point of emphasis to increase the amount of content it puts up on its YouTube pages and so on. Mm-hmm. But, for example, the J3As, and I think we've long talked about government trying to cash in on our sporting heroes. But what about the local organizations who always talk about struggling with financing and revenue? How should they better use this tool that's at their disposal to be able to possibly bring more revenue in? Because it's also a point of earning revenue.
Right. So what LA the city of Los Angeles did all their franchises, hockey, baseball, basketball, they had a company that amalgamated all those different eras, all the franchises for all the sports. And they put together a plan and they produced tweets, posts, and so on for them, which were sponsored. It was a strategy that they put together. So even although the Lakers, for example, or the Dodgers or the Angels have their own, and the Raiders have their own individuals, this company has just assembled all of them and they just get content and they just produce. So some of the things you see showing up on your timeline, for example, that is content created out of that organization. It needs to be a strategy, pretty much like your development plan. It now needs to include a digital element. And there are firms in Jamaica that can do that. For example, Cricket West Indies, because of its market, they would have done research and they still find out that even notwithstanding the people on Twitter and even Instagram, that Facebook, the kind of market that still follows the cricket so closely, Facebook is the target market. So they have probably close to 4 million or so on Facebook in terms of following. And they augment that with, to get the smaller crowd or to get the younger crowd, you know, things on Twitter, YouTube, and so on. And they live stream a lot of their events. So it captures all of that. But I think in Jamaica, one reason, I don't understand it, for example, because Jamaica in itself as a brand, it doesn't matter what kind of athlete you are, that is already a plus that you can use. But if I'm a Jamaican swimmer, a football player, a netball player, that is one step in. There are also some strategies you can use boosts. You can get a $5 boost, which can reach up to 4,000 per 10 day.
Yeah, like promote your post. But the question I want to ask is, why does it, in your estimation, why does it seem as if some of the associations, at least anyway, don't make this a priority or don't make this, as you say, a part of their development plan? You don't hear them talk about it, for example, at the AGM when they're elected president or whatever, about having greater social media presence.
Some of them can barely want to even have a media officer. I mean, some of the bigger associations sometimes don't even carry a press person, which is a basic thing, much as, you know.
Is it that they don't see it as important? The persons leading the associations themselves are out of touch with current reality?
Maybe not out of touch, but I think they're afraid to take the extra step. And part of the thing is that marketing is all-inclusive. So it has media, communications, PR, advertising. And I don't think they see themselves. They're purely operational, so all they want, they focus on performances. And I think more and more, and I also don't think that they realize that there's an economic gain to be had. So you can stream, you can offer somebody that thing that runs at the bottom. I should know these terms.
A crawl or a...
A crawl. Mm. For a 15-second crawl, that is a charge. And if you have 3.4 million people on your Facebook page or so on, it means that at least per unit, you are having 3.4 million people. And what it is to put it in a program that you can demonstrate that you're exposing a brand to that kind of market. And so I think it's probably something the GOA should undertake in terms of part of its development program, where it includes marketing and promotion as part of its going forward. We're going into 2020. We're going to Japan. How many years since we're going to Olympics? 1948. It is time we catch up. And you're going after 10 disciplines into the Olympics. I mean, when you look at Yona Knight Wisdom, Aliyah Atkinson, plus Ashley and Fraser Price, even combine those three athletes of Jamaica, they should cumulatively be attracting a lot of the attention to Jamaica. Yeah. The reggae girls, you know, that kind of... And I don't think somebody has sat down. We're not great at planning.
In fact, what I've seen, the reggae girls, the promoted posts I've seen when I scroll through my social media for the reggae girls actually comes from the Alacran group.
Right, or the Reggae Girls Foundation, which they're all connected. So that's
the other thing. Rather than the actual federation, the governing body.
That's the other thing too. And some of the names that they use as handles have nothing to do with either the sport or Jamaica. So I'm saying for branding, If it is football, it must be Jamaica football. It is netball Jamaica. It is track and field Jamaica. The IAAF is now World Athletics. And so they're saying this is what it is. So your name, your handles, and for athletes, your social media names should not be Red Hot Shiny Girl. It should be Carole Beckford. It should be Jordan Ford. Because nobody knows. So the time you're going to take for name recognition is going, by the time you start building your audience, it's going to take you so much time. So employ somebody who understands, register your domains, the first good time, the first set of goals you will score, and that kind of thing. Register your domains, because those things, Kirani James had to pay a couple thousand dollars to get KiraniJames.com.
Yeah.
And so those are some of the things that,
But there are obviously pitfalls. You can put things on Twitter, Facebook, wherever, that end up having a negative effect. We saw it, we've seen it worldwide. Bernardo Silva, for example, who plays for Manchester City, shares a joke, or what he calls a joke, with his friend. He ends up getting sanctioned, you know, by the governing body for it, because it's seen as racist.
Right.
But in terms of that,
rules apply. Yeah. So whatever you can't say, there are codes of conduct for every athlete, every player. And it follows. It doesn't mean that, so because I'm not competing, I can post something tonight. If you watch a movie and it has a character in it that you don't agree with, you cannot publicly, when you're an athlete, you don't be an athlete only when you're competing. So you can't almost share your opinion.
But then I think the downside may be that the post may look a little bit too rehearsed or too doctored, for example, and not like the real athlete themselves. Because sometimes you can tell when a post is sent out by a social media manager rather than by the athlete himself. And I think maybe bridging that gap is something.
So here's what you do. If you're going to do that, you must study your subject. It's pretty much like going to school. I mean, I've worked for athletes, and I know, I spend time with them. I know the words they spell wrong. I know how they speak. So it is almost like articulating the voice of the person.
Right.
So it doesn't seem rehearsed.
Right.
And so you can skillfully do that.
And then even there are other things. I mean, you can post something that is, you don't mention the person, you don't tag them or anything, but there's a connection made. For example, when Paul Pogba, when Jose Mourinho got sacked by Manchester United, he posted something on Instagram looking with a side eye, saying, caption this. And
yeah.
Well, his sponsor's tag was there, and he actually had to take it down. And now afterwards, he was saying that tweet was actually, or that post was actually timed or scheduled, because they actually scheduled posts as well.
Oh, that's the other thing. So that's part of the strategy. So you don't have to get up at 3 o'clock in the morning to post something. There is that application in Twitter that you can say you want this one, because you have markets in England, in Australia, and you can do that. So, I mean, let me tell you, it has become so easy these days, but there are people out there who are trained for that. And I'm saying, just like a publicist, an attorney, an accountant, a social media person, is just as important to your brand. Because look at Cristiano Ronaldo. He now has, 214 million people following him just on Instagram. In, I think, 4 years ago, he made, 176 million just for his hair product person. By his Instagram post, there's money to be made. So it's another stream. So outside of you performing on the track or on the field, it's an important economic earner. And so athletes have to see themselves as part of expanding. It's like a workforce. So whether you're known because of your performance, but there are other elements that for your brand that you can expose by being good on social media. And the recent thing that came out about the sports teams, the most tweeted about in 2019, with Barcelona still being number one, but the Lakers, which is the only American franchise, in the top 10. And it's interesting. So you had Barcelona, Real Madrid, Manchester United, Liverpool, PSG, Juventus, Manchester City, Ajax, Flamengo, and Lakers. Those were the top 10 most tweeted about. And then Google has all these analytics that can tell you what people tweet about you, when they search for you, who else they search about. So the artificial intelligence behind social media is such an incredible tool. So when you go to a partner, a sponsor partner, you can say to them, for 6 months, here's the exposure you'll get. Here is how your brand will be exposed. And so you need to be able to partner with me in that way.
Thank you very much. I'm getting that we're actually lagging behind in that regard. We could go on and on. But we're unfortunately out of time. Thank you very much to marketing and PR specialist Carole Beckford for joining us to talk about social media and its current role in the world of sport. When we come back, we're going to talk some cricket with the CEO of the Jamaica Cricket Association.